Hello everyone, thank you so much for joining us today. My name is Stephanie Cristello. I'm the Director of Programming for Expo Chicago, as well as the Editor-in-Chief of The Scene, Chicago's International Journal of Contemporary and Modern Art. We are thrilled to be presenting the Art and Architecture Symposium today as part of Dialogues. The program is presented in partnership with the School of the Art Institute of Chicago and is a year-round series of panels and symposiums featuring leading artists, curators, and art professionals on the issues that engage them. Today, we're thrilled to be presenting this panel in partnership with the Graham Foundation in alignment with the Chicago Architecture Biennial, featuring artist David Hart, who is represented by Corbett versus Dempsey in Chicago, and David Nolan in New York, in conversation with Felix Berchter, the editor-in-chief of Pinup Magazine. Please join us in welcoming our panelists. Thank you.
Thank you. Hello.
Yes.
Stephanie, thank you very much. I'm honored to have been asked to moderate this. I'm actually just interviewing. For anyone, so I'm Felix Berchter. I'm the editor of Pinup Magazine, and I think you have a copy of on all your chairs. There's a part of the reason, I think, why I was chosen to do this interview is because David wrote a piece for the current issue, which again you have on your seat, which was a sort of prelude to the exhibition that opened last night at the Graham Foundation, which if you haven't already seen it today or last night, I highly encourage you to go see. The exhibition is called In the Forest. And I would actually like to start by specifically talking about the exhibition. I've known your work now for several years, I think at least 4 or 5 years. Last night was probably the biggest exhibition I've ever seen from you, by you. But there's sort of a red thread, at least for me, and I hope you won't be offended if I start off like this. It's a fantastic exhibition over four rooms. It takes over 4 rooms, the entire Graham Foundation. And it's beautiful. It's a beautiful exhibition.
Thank you.
But there's an element of deceit for me, and this is the red thread that I'm talking about, because all the other exhibitions by you that I've seen were also beautiful, but then once you start peeling away the layers of what you see, a whole other world kind of is laid bare. So maybe you can talk a little bit about what In the Forest is about.
Sure. So In the Forest is a commission from the Graham Foundation, and what's unique about that is that about a year ago, I was approached by Sarah and Ellen from the Graham, asking me, we've had an ongoing dialogue for maybe about 5-8 years. They've supported 2 projects in the past, the first exhibition I did in Chicago, and actually my first museum exhibition as well, Straylight at the Museum of Contemporary Art in 2011. They supported the publication. More recently, in 2015, I did an exhibition in Los Angeles at LAX Art called Interval, and that body of work came to the Art Institute of Chicago, and they contributed towards the production of that work. But this was a unique commission in which they just said, carte blanche, what do you want to do? Where do you want to go? What are you thinking about? And it was a huge opportunity. In the Forest is a meditation on Moshe Safdie's 1968 project called Habitat Puerto Rico. And you might be familiar with his Habitat 67 project, which took place in relationship to Expo 67 in Montreal. The project that he did next was Habitat Puerto Rico, or at least the project that he began next was Habitat Puerto Rico. And I had just finished a project, and it's the 50th anniversary of Safdie's Expo 67, and I was I have the same provenance as Expo 67, in as much as I was born in Montreal in 67. Perhaps I was coming to terms with my own mortality, or just also celebrating the legacy of that project and looking at his book, For Everyone a Garden. And I turned the page, and there was a wonderful image of Habitat Puerto Rico, the site, which is this beautiful forested hill in San Juan that the project was slated to go in. And construction actually never began there. But I had been working on another project, and I frequently use Google Earth as a means for scouting locations when I'm shooting. And I thought, oh, it'd be really interesting to find where that is in relationship to the urban context of San Juan. It was an aerial shot. There was the mountain. There was a commercial plaza in the foreground. So I had a few landmarks to go off of. And very quickly was able to find that vantage point. And I became deeply curious about the future that actually came to fruition on that site in lieu of Habitat Puerto Rico. It became a nature reserve, a botanical garden, and for me that's it's another kind of positive outcome. So I thought, oh, it'd be really interesting at some point in the future to do something around that. And maybe 2 weeks later is when I got the call from the Graham, and I was like, actually, I have this project that's kind of been I've just begun thinking about it. And I said I'd love to go down to Puerto Rico, do some scouting, see what's actually there. And I did that, and that's when, speaking of like layers of the onion that are kind of peeled back, that I was able to really kind of discover a whole city, a whole world of part of Safdie's legacy that hadn't really been remembered or entirely actually forgotten. There's an aspect of cultural amnesia there, because actually production did begin, and they worked on the project from 68 through 72. And then abandoned it due to engineering problems and an inability to bring it in at a cost per unit price that was part of the initial mandate. So it was originally funded by HUD. And I, through some research and through some collaborators on site in Puerto Rico and at Penn where I teach, we were able to uncover the actual site of construction, which is essentially a small city in the woods in the borough of Carolina, just outside of San Juan. Additionally, there are other units that were originally intended for that site that were scattered all over the island. And in the film and in the photographs in the installation at the Graham Foundation, I actually visit two of those sites. One, which is a clearly kind of abandoned scattering of units in the landscape in the south of Puerto Rico, and then one which has been repurposed as a cow shed perched on a hillside on the interior. So I think just as a kind of foreground, I wanted to lay that out in the relationship with the Graham. But I mean, in terms of this red thread that you see in the work, for me, architecture kind of functions as a lens through which I can begin to kind of examine the conditions and context that that it exists within. I like to say that the work is kind of meditation on the relationship between ideology and the built environment. And it's interesting, as you kind of see the work, there's a sense of fascination and to some extent a bit of spectacle that draws you in. But then as you kind of move heuristically, as I did, through the kind of landscape that's been presented, these layers, as you said, begin to kind of reveal themselves. I think with the Puerto Rico project in the forest, there's a kind of really kind of deep and singular focus, and it's an extremely complex site, and the histories are complex, and there's a lot of push-pull from formerly kind of dichotomous positions. So north-south, interior-exterior, public-private, these are things that emerge in a really complicated way and they become blurred in a way where the positions are perhaps more fixed in other projects.
I'm curious because you know, this is the origin was, of course, your the Expo 67, which is considered by all accounts a success story to this day, a utopia that was actually built. The Puerto Rico, what is actually the proper name for it?
Habitat Puerto Rico.
Habitat Puerto Rico is a failure by all standards. Is it the failed utopia that interested you in the project, or?
No, not at all. In fact, I think that was one of the things I was actually trying to resist, was that characterization, in as much as I think that there are a lot of artists that do focus on it and are quite successful. But it seemed to me to be a very conventional approach to the site, if you will. And I think that you know, there's a what do you call it? There's a pathetic quality to it, you know, I didn't want to take advantage of that. Right, and I didn't want it to be so damning. I thought that there was an opportunity, and that's why actually I was more interested initially, at least, in the site where the garden bloomed, right, where the nature park took hold. For me, that was an equally valuable and successful outcome. And I think that, you know, the dialectic between the success of Habitat Montreal, Habitat 67, and initially the success of this nature reserve in Puerto Rico, for me, it was really promising. Once you began to kind of peel back the layers, you understood that there were all of these other components that were present. And I agree with you that the project, as it was initially conceived, was a failure. But a different future kind of manifested out of that. And that, for me, is deeply interesting.
So what the distinction that you are making is that it's not necessarily a modern ruin. It's actually a monument. It's a monument to something else.
I think that's a really great way of putting it. For me, it's a, I think, a monument in many ways to the failures of the project of modernity, right? The kind of great promise of, through the use of contemporary construction and building technologies and, you know, kind of democratic concept of design, that we could bring a better quality of life to everyone. The tension there is that usually, Rainer Bannon writes about this quite eloquently, and so does Peter Blake, this idea of mega projects. They're quite hierarchical and authoritarian in terms of their conception, right? A very small group of designers and planners, very small group of developers are going to design a better future for all. And to kind of exist within that environment, it already has a kind of dynamic tension built in. And what makes the city great and interesting is, in fact, the diversity of bodies and ideas and design approaches and uses that we as citizens contribute to it. So to diminish the kind of participation that many modernist projects actually do is also to diminish the richness and potential of the city.
The exhibition and the project is called In the Forest, which it's an obvious title because it's in the forest, but it's actually it's a quote from Le Triste Tropique.
Yeah, from Claude Levi-Strauss.
Can you explain a little bit about?
Yeah, sure. So the title In the Forest is actually a chapter heading in Claude Levi-Strauss's Triste Tropique, and it's a chapter that kind of begins where he's kind of reminiscing on his life in France. He's thinking about you know, his love of the mountains and then his love of the sea. All the while he's following some indigenous tribespeople in Brazil in the rainforest. And there's this a beautiful kind of sense of expansion that one kind of receives as he both time travels and travels across various geographies within his mind. And the reason I was reading Triste Tropique was in some ways to kind of try to better understand my own practice, which is quite itinerant, you know, having made films in Russia and in the Yukon and in Greece and in the island of Tuvalu in the South Pacific, and always in search of what I kind of think of as these singularities, which are places that in my mind are like hyper-compressed exemplars of an ideological position. So the book, is a kind of meditation by Strauss on Levi Strauss by on his practice as an anthropologist and trying to understand the moral dimensions of what that means, what it means to be to encounter the other. So I was reading the book, recognizing I think those aspects within my own, my own practice, and trying to come to terms with, to some extent, a kind of cultural exploitation. So
a cultural exploitation in your own work, or
yeah.
With regards to the specifically to the Moshe Safdie?
No, within my own practice. Yeah. So to kind of, for me, to kind of publicly kind of declare an acknowledgement of that aspect of the work, and in as much as these places are singularities and highly representative of that ideological position, there's also an essentialization that's happening where I'm kind of diluting all of the other kind of aspects of what they are, or perhaps opening it up. Maybe it is a process of distillation where kind of the richest and most vital kind of elements of that place kind of come to the fore. So, but it's interesting. It was just to try and kind of bring that forward. And initially, it's almost kind of coincidental intuitive. Just doing a project in Puerto Rico that deals with this this failure, as you put it. The title Tris Tropiques is an almost kind of obvious one, but for me it was too on the nose. So in reading the book and also seeing the potential of the chapter title, it just opened it up a little bit.
Well, I think the reference is again because it's also, it brings up the idea of intellectual colonialism, and colonialism actually, period, no. How, and Puerto Rico being, actually, that's a whole other kind of forms, I suppose, is a modern, you could describe as a modern colony.
Yes.
How did that figure into the, into also in the physical manifestation of the exhibition at the Grand Foundation?
I think that's another component of the dialectic, in fact. So when we think of the circumstances in which Expo 67 kind of came to life, it was during the World's Fair, and it was the centennial of Canada's independence from British rule. So Canada was celebrating their independence as post-colonial independence. They were, there was a clear kind of focus on ideas and putting forth, through projects like Habitat 67, an assertion that kind of demonstrated Canada as a contemporary state, right? That was using the modern project to present, to the world its,
and they were exporting that.
Exactly, its sophistication. And then, the corollary to that, obviously, is Puerto Rico's current status as a colony, the failure of the project, and in many ways also the failures of the neoliberal project as well. It's both looking kind of at the conditions at the time when the commission happened, but also very much kind of projecting forward 50 years and trying to understand the contemporaneity of both situations.
You compared, in the text that you wrote for Pinup, you compared the work of In the Forest with painting, 18th century painting by, I'm going to look this up, by
Hubert Robert.
Yes, thank you. Can you describe what you could, where you saw the parallels?
Sure. So I think, I've always been interested in the work of Robert and Cataletto, classic painters doing renditions of cities and ruins. I recognized in the work that I was making that there was a deep connection to Robert's representation of Paris at the time. And
which was depicted largely in ruins, actually.
In ruins, so the Louvre as a ruin. What's the name of the bridge? I'm blanking the name. Pont-Neuf, yeah. So the destruction of the Pont-Neuf. He was looking at a city that was under massive transformation. And I wish I could take credit for this analysis, but in fact, it's built very heavily on the writing of Nina Dubin, who's a UIC-based art historian. And she writes incredibly eloquently on the context within which Robert was producing those paintings in response to what he saw as the massive modernization of Paris in service of a speculative real estate market. To compare that to the contemporary conditions that are present in Puerto Rico. So through the economic collapse, a lot of families and businesses are having to sell off their assets. And there's a massive speculative market coming from Latin America and the US just buying up these assets for bargain basement prices. So there's an extreme exploitation of the Puerto Rican people that's happening right now. And to kind of draw a relationship between Paris at that time and Puerto Rico today, and using the ruin of Safi as a kind of nexus that allows me to kind of address this historical trajectory.
I would like to talk a little bit about the notion of periphery, specifically with regards to In the Forest, to the exhibition, the project, but also maybe with regards to some of your other work. I'm not sure if you said it or if I read this about you, but I think you'd like to explore the periphery to understand the center. Very simply put. Some of like you said, you've worked in the Yukon, in Sakhalin, which I think is the southernmost island of Russia and the Japanese archipelago. Yes, thank you. You go to these far flung places to search for truth, or what is it?
I think
what draws you there?
Yeah, I mean, it's a bit of trying to cut down the signal to noise ratio. The idea is to kind of go to the periphery in order to examine the pathologies of the center. And I wish, again, I could lay claim to that as a methodology, but in fact, it's something that I borrowed from Chekhov and Glenn Gould. So the piece that you're referring to is Interval. And in that work, I was trying to explore the nature of globalization. And if you will, the work was based on two historical journeys that were taken by two artists that I relate to a very clear sense of national identity. So Chekhov, at the height of his fame, left Moscow and traveled to Sakhalin, which is on the extreme edge in the Pacific, so the extreme edge of Russia. And as Felix said, it's actually part of the Japanese archipelago, the very top. It was a penal colony at the time. And he went and actually did a work of investigative journalism, which is about 400 or 500 pages long. It's his only work of nonfiction. And he did it deliberately in order to talk about the Tsarist regime, but at a safe distance. So really talking about the failures of Russian society, through this kind of peripheral perspective. It gave him the critical distance necessary in order to be able to examine, a concept of national identity. And Gould did the same thing with the idea of North, which was an incredibly important radio book, incredibly important for me because I'm a Canadian, but I don't expect everybody to have the same relationship to it. It's a piece that Gould did after giving up his career as a performing musician. He began doing these experimental radio plays, and in it he wanted to examine the concept of Canadian identity, and he traveled North through proxies, people who had lived and worked in the North, and he created this radio play, which is basically a set of layered dialogues where people are retelling their experience of having lived and worked in the North. So that's where the genesis comes in terms of that methodology. I found it to be extremely useful. And it also helped me identify locations where I could examine this notion of globalization without the kind of interference of everything else that was going on. And as you know, the project was initially shown in Los Angeles, again, it was a commission from LAX Art, and they asked me where I wanted to cite it, and it wasn't necessary that I cite it in the gallery, so instead I chose to cite it at the Bonaventure, which is Frederick Jameson's kind of exemplar structure that symbolizes the postmodern condition. And for me, to be able to, you know, show the piece in this space, which as Jameson kind of refers to as being entirely deracinated, right? A space that could exist everywhere in the world. So this idea of...
Like habitat,
precisely. Yeah, that you could host this concept, you know, of globalization within a structure that was essentially an amplifier for that condition. Yeah.
Architecture plays such an important role in your work. In fact, it's in a lot of your work, it's the protagonist. Humans, less so. But how important that there's yet there's always a human presence. Can you talk about the relationship and why you choose to often not present a human presence, even though it informs your work? Or does it? I don't know.
I think it does. I mean, I think it's interesting. I've got Dawood Bey, who's sitting here, is an absolute phenomenal portrait photographer. And his relationship with the human figure and being able to, in many ways, kind of essentialize the character of that individual is something that terrified me. You know, it's something that I felt like I don't have the wherewithal to even begin to do that. And architecture provides me with a convenient proxy through which I can explore the history of ideas of a culture, of a society. And I'm always interested in this relationship between, as I said, ideology and the built environment and how they're continuously out of phase, right? So when a building is conceived, there's a specific ideological agenda that allows for its construction. But that ideology and the structure that houses it aren't always in phase. For any ideology to be accepted and vital, it needs to change. It needs to work in response to the cultural conditions that it finds itself in. Architecture moves much more slowly than that. So in order to kind of be able to chart the traces of, you know, the cultural and social and political and economic histories of an idea, it's almost like through architecture you can examine the strata of, you know, what came before. Yeah.
So where do you see the parallels in places like Puerto Rico, Sakhalin, the Yukon? What, and are there, or is it for you the same project, or is it a different?
Oh, that's a great question. I've never been asked that before. Yeah, I think. Actually, I can go back to a kind of an earlier kind of conception of the work, which for me was a, sort of a blueprint, if you will, of the entire project, which was, so it's not simply just an ideological position, but it's a representation of all ideological positions, right? To be able to create a spectrum and not to differentiate between one approach or another, not to create a hierarchy. Right?
And when you say not to create a hierarchy between approaches, you mean political approaches or?
Ideological.
Ideological.
Which incorporates the political, absolutely. So, you know, the work that I did at the Mackinac Center for Public Policy, which is a conservative free market think tank that does a lot of policy work for the Republican Party.
This is the piece with Francis Fukuyama.
No, this is a piece called Belvedere, and it was shown at MoMA last year. That piece you know, it looks at, you know, essentially a right-wing agenda, and the mechanics that go behind it, the thinking, the apparatus that allows its dissemination. The piece that you're referring to is a piece that I just showed in Germany this past summer at Galerie Thomas Schulz, and its title is The Last Poet. And in it, it's a meditation on the eastern seaboard of the United States as a megalopolis, as referred to by Jean Gottman, the urban theorist. And what I was doing was relating that geography and its the relationship between cities as far-flung as Boston and Atlanta and their sharing of common resources like infrastructure and human resources and capital. So Gottman put forth, you know, this idea of their interconnectedness and was further kind of theorized through the writing, the science fiction writing of William Gibson with his Sprawl trilogy. So I flew a drone from Boston to Atlanta over 14 days to make a film of the region and also to equate it to the European Union, which at the time of filming was experiencing an extreme crisis of identity. And then I followed up by spending 2 days at Stanford University interviewing Francis Fukuyama and the result of that interview became the voiceover for the film, and him commenting on the political crisis in Europe and the impending political crisis in the United States. And for me, I mean, most of us know him for his incredibly important book, 1992, The End of History and The Last Man. And for him to kind of, which was an assertion of, you know, the success of liberal democracies over over communism. And
which was largely used or misused as the blueprint for neoconservatism.
Exactly, absolutely. And he was a participant with that through his service of the Bush administration and his early advocation of the war in Iraq, which he recanted, but nonetheless, that was his position. And it's incredibly interesting and actually quite touching to hear him comment on the failures of those potentials and the state of decay of liberal democracies globally.
But to go back to my question, when you go to these places, it sounds like, when you go to
I forgot the question, didn't I?
You kind of avoided it.
Sorry.
When you go to these, you said it was a good one, and then you didn't answer it. So when you go to the Yukon, when you go to Sakhalin, when you go to Puerto Rico, is this project always the same? Ultimately, is it part of the same project? Are you looking for the same thing, or looking for the same answers, or the same questions, or are you asking the same questions, or do you not see them related?
No, I see them related in as much as there are different nodes on that spectrum, right? So the spectrum being all potential ideological positions. So they're related in as much as they share that they occupy a space within that spectrum, but they each occupy a unique space on that spectrum, and they each contribute unique ideas towards the human condition.
I'm curious also about the how, so you spend average at least, I would say 2 weeks a month maybe, when you travel, when you do these projects. How do you decide and how do you distill all these impressions, all this research, how do you distill that into an actual show and an exhibition? And you use, it's various medias, it's video, it's photography. For those who haven't seen the show at the Grand Foundation, there are planters and plants and sculptures. What does that process happen? And can you speak to that?
Yeah, I mean, it's quite complex, and there's a lot of back and forth, and I'm really fortunate for working with such amazing galleries and institutions who kind of trust the process of invention. You know, I could describe the way that this project, you know, began and what my proposal looked like, and the folks at the Graham, they followed the various permutations. And I think that, you know, for me, I work really hard on creating, through research, a conceptual framework in which the work can exist. And once I've done that, it really frees me to kind of explore a lot of the tools that an artist has at hand in terms of form, in terms of composition, in terms of, you know, at least in terms of filmmaking and photography, depth of field, framing, in terms of sculpture materials and color and volume. So understanding, you know, those dimensions and trying to, again, this process of distillation, how do you take something that you see as being present in the forum and distill it down so that it's not entirely indexical, that it's not entirely related to its relationship to the subject. So there's a process of abstraction that happens in which I'm trying to remove the bonds that connect it in an indexical way to whatever it is that's supposed to reference, but that it has its own kind of object identity that is independent, but begins to, I guess, haunt the work in a productive way and unveils itself through various kind of modes that are run either in contradictory fashion or in complementary fashion to the experience of viewing.
So would you mind actually walking us through some of the pieces that are in the show at the Graham? I mean, there's, like I said, there's, and that maybe that process of decision making of what you were going to show beyond video, you know, documentation in that you did while there.
Sure. So I think the context of the Graham, which is this beautiful building, I think it was 1901. There are hallmarks of Art Deco and Prairie style. You know, it's extremely ornate, but also very modern at the same time. The possibility of doing an exhibition in that context was as influential as everything else, and really trying to maximize an interaction with the environment.
Well, it's also it's a very residential space, actually. It's originally a residential space.
Yeah. So, I mean, there are a lot of kind of dichotomous ideas that were initially presented. Public-private, interior, exterior, the Graham's location on the Gold Coast with a beautiful garden outside and the honey locust trees that surround it. North-south in terms of the location of the exhibition and the relationship with its subject, which is in Puerto Rico. And trying to break down those boundaries and instead create a more kind of blurred or hybrid kind of concept of their potentials. So in that sense, I was thinking about how do I occupy the space to kind of have the work itself kind of respond productively to that operation. So having something that was distributed throughout the space and creating a kind of ambient experience, using the apertures of the window, the windows and the vistas kind of that lay beyond them, and relating that to what was actually happening within the space of the gallery was also important. So in terms of layout, that was critical in terms of like how does one move through the space. In terms of the elements, there is aluminum sculptures, and their form is based on the roof line of Safdie's Habitat project, but it's been abstracted and their color is also shifted. So they're laser cut and bent aluminum sheets that are about half an inch thick and about 8 feet long. And for me, the scale was deeply important because I neither wanted it to be a model, nor did I want it to be architecture. What's the scale of sculpture, right? And that's what I wanted it to be thought of. So there's these sculptural entities. There's a series of ceramic forms that have two orientations. One is as a planter, and they're scattered around and they house tropical plants that are native to Puerto Rico. And
curious, I'm sorry I'm nerding out on these things, but what is the shape of these planters based on?
The shape is something I devised, but it references in some ways Safdie's architectural approach, which is modular objects that through their through a kind of constellation, they can provide a multitude of uses. So, you know, in nature, the honeycomb form is one that's, you know, that's been adapted as something that, you know, through its compression, you could actually have a lot of kind of separate modules. So, you know, I actually based the scale of it on an alto stool, which is in my studio, which, you know, is just the right height off the ground. And it's what I did is I, you know, took the honeycomb shape and extruded it to make clear that it did have two orientations. I expanded one of the ends slightly. And it also, when it's in its planter configuration, it's on the narrow end. And when it's in its seat orientation, it's on the thicker end, which provides more stability. It's funny because yesterday at the opening, it was quite packed, and one of the sculptural pieces, the aluminum pieces, is out in the garden, and it begins to relate to the fragments, the architectural fragments of the Graham Foundation. And I heard that people were setting their drinks upon it. And I, you know, initially I was outraged. I'm like, that's terrible, it's sculpture, what are you doing? But then I've also created these hexagonal shapes that people were sitting on. And I'm like, actually, maybe no, maybe it's cool. Maybe I should encourage that. But the other elements are a 20-minute film whose score drifts through all of the galleries. In fact, there are speakers in all of the galleries, so I think it also adds to the kind of ambient quality of one's experience. And a suite of 7 photographs, which detail the various sites.
I have a final question before we pass the mic to the audience. Is there, with any of the in the forest or any of the previous, is there any relevance for you to actually take the work and bring it back to the place where it was created and show it there, or is it no interest for you to do that?
That's a really interesting question. I think that, I've learned a little bit, I mean, as some of the shows that I've made have toured, the possible resonances between the subject of the work and the context that it's exhibited in. The first piece that I did in Chicago, the Straylight work, its subject was the Johnson Publishing Company building on Michigan Avenue. So obviously there was a deep resonance between that piece and the history of Chicago, and also a kind of commentary on African-American identity and the importance of Johnson Publishing as a kind of beacon, you know, within the community. And the show traveled to the Henry Museum in Seattle, Henry Art Gallery in Seattle, and also to the Carnegie in Pittsburgh. But it also made a stop in Harlem at the Studio Museum. And I recognized how the resonance of the work changed based on the context that it was shown in. I'm not saying that, you know, that it was any less appreciated in the Seattle context, but I understood how it performed differently. So no, I haven't had the opportunity to show, you know, the work in the Yukon or on the island of Tuvalu, but I do recognize the kind of resonance that the work has to a locale.
Well, I would like to, it's really hard to see, but if there are any questions from the audience, now is the time to speak up.
I was wondering how the hurricane and other weather conditions affect hikes in the work, if at all.
How the hurricane, the recent hurricanes have affected.
Does that affect your view on how you're using the work?
How I'm using the work or see the work? I don't think one could have anticipated that per se. It was interesting, it did affect the time of our press release, and doing something that you know, had Puerto Rico as its subject, there was a kind of callousness in just kind of doing a release for an art exhibition. So I think we were very concerned, and we thought about whether or not we should acknowledge that before actually announcing the exhibition. But in fact, based on what happened, it didn't seem necessary. That being said, global warming does factor in an earlier piece of work of mine, which is Adrift, which examines the fate of the Tuvaluese people who, Tuvalu, an island in the South Pacific, a group of atolls actually, the highest point on any of them is 3 feet, and Tuvalu will be one of the first countries on the planet eradicated due to global warming. And the film is a speculation on, it's a science fiction film. Martine Sims, who's a wonderful artist based in Los Angeles, she and I collaborated and she wrote the screenplay for it. But it imagines the Tuvaluese having fled the atolls and resettled on the banks of the Mississippi. So, you know, perhaps I'm not necessarily obviously kind of responding real time to conditions. Global warming as a reality is something that I am concerned with.
Yeah. Another question?
Ah, yes.
Just based on something you just said, which was the two islands that have, the first two islands having been eradicated by the climate change. And I know that those are two dirty words, but I thought I would throw it in there because it's obvious that it is. And I thought it would be wonderful if dialogue and visual on the first two planets were sent to appropriate agencies in Washington to make them aware of the fact that here's the beginning. And that's all. Just as a intense and terrifying illumination of poetry in our culture. That's it. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. And I think it's interesting that you say that. I mean, one of the realities that's kind of present within the film, and for me, a kind of deeply terrifying one. So I made the film on the island of Tuvalu in the South Pacific, but it's presented actually as the banks of the Mississippi. And one of the things that I think we forget is that the tropics are encroaching, right? That they're actually moving north. And for me, that was incredibly terrifying as a visual, right? To kind of see and recognize that tropical environment represented as a place that we're more or less familiar with. And that's the reality. That was the reality that I was trying to present when a kind of a warning and how much and how quickly the world is changing. You know, I think it's actually really interesting. I see Emily here. Maybe she can help me remember. The piece was actually shown at a conference here recently in Chicago, that was a conference on activism. And a curator who was doing programming for the conference asked for the piece as an example of artists who are engaging in a kind of activism that's relating to these global concerns. Yeah.
Well, thank you. I think if there are any other questions, I would like to just encourage everyone to go to Grand Foundation and see the show In the Forest, David Hart. And thank you everyone for coming and for engaging with us. And yes.
Thank you, Felix.